we're very excited about our external seminar speaker who has come from the BI and from Beth Israel. But actually first, we're going to introduce our early stage investigator who always gives a talk and then introduces our external seminar speaker. So I'm very excited about introducing Dr. Sarah Gutin. And she is a social behavioral scientist, had her PhD from the University of Michigan and then an MPH from the University of Cape Town. And she has come here as a TAPS fellow. And we are super excited because she works on reproductive health and HIV care in the global context, which is really what our external seminar speaker, Dr. Rebecca Zash, does. She's worked in multiple countries in Sub-Saharan Africa, and most recently has been interested in mobility and looking at the question of mobility with HIV risk factors in Kenya and Uganda among couples. And so she is going to present her talk, which is couple-based approaches for safer conception, prevention of HIV in Sub-Saharan Africa, and then introduce Dr. Zash. So thank you so much, Sarah, for being here.
Thank you so much, Dr. Gandhi. Thank you so much for having me. It is really a pleasure and an honor to be here today, especially with the ESI awardees. I'm just so happy to be here and have a chance to talk to you about my work in the area of couples-based approaches for safer conception and the prevention of HIV in Sub-Saharan Africa. So I'd like to take you on a bit of a 20-year journey through my research. In the early years of my research, from about 2004 to 2008, I was focused on the family planning methods for women living with HIV. And when it came to family planning, women were always saying, we can use a method of family planning, but a lot of it depends on my partner, and the men aren't involved. And honestly, a lot of us, the women, the providers, we did a lot of complaining about men. Where were the men? And then in I didn't forward my slides. It's not working. I did. Oh, now it's working. Thank you. So in 2008, I moved to San Francisco and I started work on a positive health, dignity, and prevention program in Mozambique in collaboration with Carol Dawson Rose at the UCSF School of Nursing. And my work was very prevention focused. But in about 2012, the data that showed the full power of treatment as prevention and PrEP were becoming available. And I felt that the populations that I was working with really didn't know that. And I also knew the other side of the family planning coin was that there were women who wanted to become pregnant. And there were suddenly a lot of great options to protect HIV-affected couples. And so in 2013, I moved to Michigan to start my PhD with a focus on safer conception. There we go. So what is safer conception? Safer conception includes both behavioral and pharmacologic reproductive strategies to reduce HIV transmission to partners during conception. And this includes things like PrEP, ART, manual vaginal self-insemination, and medical male circumcision. And Sub-Saharan African data shows that the desire for children among people living with HIV is high. And Safer Conception is a growing sexual and reproductive health service for people living with HIV in Sub-Saharan Africa and can be an entry point for HIV prevention. But current interventions to improve safer conception uptake have neglected to address couple relationship dynamics and have been underutilized for high priority HIV risk populations in Sub-Saharan Africa. Whoops, too many. Nope, there we go. So in my dissertation, I conducted three studies in Botswana, and I wanted to highlight some of the key findings of those studies. First, we found that couples discuss childbearing desires, and they also anticipate stigma from their healthcare providers about their childbearing. Also, traditional gender norms, HIV stigma, and the lack of social support for male engagement were barriers to the increased uptake of safer conception. Also, couple communication facilitated safer conception service uptake, and community-based efforts were really needed to reach men and couples to reduce the stigma around accessing sexual and reproductive health and HIV services. And so in general, what the women were saying was that if the men are involved, we can choose a safer conception method. It was all about agreeing with your partner. And so I wondered, how do we get men involved? So male engagement in HIV prevention and care and sexual and reproductive health in services in Sub-Saharan Africa improves HIV outcomes for women and infants particularly in the areas of HIV counseling and testing and maternal and newborn health. And male partners exert a strong impact on childbearing decisions in sub-Saharan Africa. And these decisions are frequently made at the couple level. Also, many new HIV infections in sub-Saharan Africa occur in long-term serodifferent relationships and may be due to attempts to become pregnant. But couples interventions have traditionally assumed stability and co-residence and have not adequately reached mobile populations at the highest risk of HIV transmission, acquisition, and care disengagement. And so this dissertation work then brought me back to UCSF in 2019 when I started as a postdoc at the traineeship for AIDS prevention studies. And when I came back, I got involved in three different projects dealing in different areas related to couples, relationship dynamics, and HIV risk. Oh, I'm having a lot of slide issues today. So safer conception is a strategy to prevent HIV transmission and is an entry point for lifelong HIV prevention efforts. But I wondered, if male involvement and social support are so critical to safer conception, is there a good way to measure it? And there really were no good scales. And so, mentored by Drs. Lene Darbus, Mallory Johnson, and Tor Nealens, we're currently adapting and then testing measures of HIV-specific social support for safer conception and male involvement in safer conception. And this work is ongoing as part of a CFAR Mentored Scientist Award, on which I'm the PI. And this work is being conducted in Vulindlela, a rural subdistrict in KwaZulu-Natal, South Africa, in collaboration with the Human Sciences Research Council. I also wanted to learn about the sexual and reproductive health needs of vulnerable mobile couples. And so collaborating with Drs. Camlin, Charlebois, and Nealens, we used retrospective cohort study data to conduct a longitudinal multi-level analysis exploring the impacts of mobility on HIV risk behaviors in rural couples in Kenya and Uganda. And we found that sexual risk behaviors within couples were impacted by typologies of mobility. So the reasons or forms of mobility, for example, were you traveling for labor or non-labor related reasons? And we also found that it was impacted by the gender of the mobile partner. And so these findings really demonstrated that there were HIV risks for men and women associated with mobility, and there was a need for prevention approaches attentive to the risk-enhancing context of mobility. And the last study I want to talk about is that I've been collaborating with Dr. Amy Conroy to conduct dyadic analyses to examine if relationship dynamics are associated with HIV stigma experienced outside of relationships. Whoops. There we go. And we found that higher sexual satisfaction and also higher partner support were associated with less anticipated stigma, and also that increased anticipated stigma was associated with higher ART non-adherence. And so we found that supportive relationships may buffer the harmful associations between stigma and adherence. So this brings me to 2023, when I became recently an assistant professor here at UCSF in the School of Nursing. And my interest in safer conception and couples and male engagement have led me to my newly funded KO1, which is named Couples Advancing Together for Safer Conception. And I just want to highlight again, we know that current interventions to improve safer conception uptake have neglected to address couple relationship dynamics. And so we're going to be adapting an innovative couple-based HIV prevention intervention called JAMI-BORA to improve relationship dynamics, things like communication, and promote male engagement in sexual and reproductive health services for mobile fisher folk in Kisumu, Kenya. And this is a 5-year KO1 being funded by NIMH, and that recently got funded this year. So the overall goal here of that study then is that we will have a couples-based intervention that improves relationship dynamics and male engagement in safer conception, and that can then be tested in a full study. And ideally, the study will facilitate the long-term goal of protecting and affirming reproductive rights, reducing HIV incidence among couples and their children, and can also be a starting point for improved engagement in care. I'd like to take a moment just to thank the women living with HIV and the couples who shared their time and insights with me. Thank you. Thank you also to my mentors, many of whom are here in the room today, and also appreciate the funding that I've received from the CFAR and NIMH. and I'm happy to take any questions. Thank you. I can hear you. Thank you. Thank you for that question. You know, we've been talking about Cabale recently and how we can try to integrate that into this study. You know, I think we know from fishermen that we've been doing some formative work and they're really interested in these couples-based approaches. And a lot of them are not super interested in a daily PrEP pill. And so we think there's going to be a lot of interest in a long-acting injectable PrEP. So we are looking into opportunities for that. And part of the formative work will be to work with providers and health facilities in Kenya to figure out the best ways to link people with those facilities in clinic or to try to get them those services out at the community level. Thank you.
Sarah's great talk. Just in light of your findings around mobility and the impact on risk, how are you going to consider that in terms of your intervention development moving forward?
That's a great question. Thank you very much, Dr. Pukes. So part of it is that we're planning to take the intervention to the couples really out into the community level. As we noted, this is a very mobile population. We are going to be pretty flexible with the timing of the intervention, that it would be something that they would get over a number of weeks, but the timing is not, you know, specifically set. This is going to be a couples-based intervention, so it's got to be something that, you know, when both partners can be together. So we have to be pretty flexible with their movement, with people moving to different beaches in search of fish. So in general, we're trying to stay very flexible and open to accommodating that mobility because these are really the hardest to reach people. And so we're gonna do a lot of formative work, working with men and couples, women as well, you know, to see where can we best reach you? What is easiest for you? Where would you want to get these services? Because generally we know they don't wanna come to the health facility. They don't wanna make that time because they lose a day of work. So there's going to be a lot of formative work there, but the plan is really to try to take it to the men, take it to the couples, take it to places where they feel comfortable. Thank you.
Do you want to go ahead?
Yes. All right. Well, it is my great pleasure then to introduce our speaker today, Dr. Rebecca Zash. Dr. Zash is faculty in the Division of Infectious Diseases at Beth Israel Deaconess Medical Center in Boston, seeing inpatients with general infectious diseases and directing the ID Reproductive Health Outpatient Clinic. She is also assistant professor at the Harvard Medical School. Dr. Zash graduated from the University of North Carolina School of Medicine before moving to Beth Israel Deaconess Medical Center for her internal medicine residency and ID fellowship, and then stayed on to become faculty. Dr. Zash is an expert in the area of antiretroviral safety in pregnancy and adverse birth outcomes. Her research is based in Botswana, where she focuses on the impact of HIV and antiretroviral therapy on pregnancy and improving systems to collect pregnancy safety data in low resource settings. She is also a member of the DHHS Perinatal HIV Guidelines Committee and the Sub-Saharan Congenital Anomalies Network. Dr. Zash also helps to lead and has worked on a large birth outcomes surveillance study in Botswana for the past 10 years, the TAPAMO study, which examines the comparative safety of antiretroviral treatments in pregnancy. Dr. Zash and her team made international news in May 2018 when preliminary data from the TAPAMO study suggested a slightly raised risk of neural tube defects in infants exposed to dolutegravir at the time of conception. This led to safety warnings being issued in the US and Europe, and a number of sub-Saharan African countries issuing policies to suspend the use of dolutegravir among women of childbearing age. I know Dr. Zash is going to speak more about this today. Currently, Dr. Zash is examining the safety of long-acting PrEP during breastfeeding, as well as issues of weight and hypertension in pregnancy. While I have not worked directly with Dr. Zash, we've collaborated with many of the same researchers in Botswana, and we were just talking this week about how we need to develop a preconception intervention together. Dr. Zash, I look forward to that opportunity, and I'm honored to welcome you to UCSF today. Her talk is entitled Antiretroviral Safety in Pregnancy. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Zash. Can you see me over the computer? Okay, great. It's a chronic problem. Thank you so much for having me today. It's really exciting to actually travel and be here in person. I haven't done this in a long time. I'm gonna kind of take a whirlwind tour through my research on the safety of antiretroviral medications in pregnancy. All right, so to set the stage, about 50% or more of the global population of people living with HIV are cisgender women of reproductive age. And you have to take an HIV medication every day for the rest of your life. So the magnitude of antiretroviral treatment exposures in pregnancy due to HIV actually outweighs that seen for any other drug in history in pregnancy. And in Botswana, where I work, one in four of all the births in the country have been exposed to antiretrovirals in utero. Around the world, there's more than a million people who become pregnant every year on antiretrovirals. And if you can look in those blue bars there, most of these people now have started their antiretrovirals before conception. So huge amounts of antiretroviral exposures every year. And obviously this is a good thing, right? PMTCT programs have been one of our biggest public health successes. UNAIDS estimates that about 3 million pediatric HIV infections have been averted and nearly a million deaths because we've gotten pregnant people on antiretrovirals. So you'd think that with HIV and pregnancy being so common that we would really know if antiretrovirals are safe in pregnancy. But historically that hasn't been the case. These are the 58 approved ARVs and combo pills. And the only one that has an FDA indication for pregnancy dates back to 1987 with AZT, which fortunately we don't use anymore. But it's not just FDA approval, right? That's hard, that's tricky. It's really getting any pregnancy safety data at all. What this figure shows, can I use the, doesn't work, is that red circle is the time of drug approval for adults. And the blue circles are the amount number of years that it has taken to get any pregnancy data. So this is like basic PK data, not large safety data. And the median for the drugs that we have is about 6 years. And it's really not gotten much better for the newer drugs. If you see dolutegravir is there around 5 years, elvitegravir 6 years, darunavir 8 years. So again, this is just basic pregnancy data after approval on adults. And obviously it's challenging to study medications in pregnancy. There's a lack of inclusion of pregnant people in clinical trials during drug development. Also, you really need conception and early first trimester data to understand pregnancy safety. And you can't do that in a clinical trial. You really can't enroll people and then expect them to get pregnant. So because people get pregnant on medications, they need the drugs. So it happens outside of clinical trials. We have this reliance on post-marketing pharmacovigilance. And we have some big systems set up, WHO, FDA, the antiretroviral pregnancy registry. But all of these systems require voluntary reporting by healthcare providers. I don't think we're very good at that, to say the least. Maybe you are here, but we certainly aren't. And the other thing is that these basically collect data, but from unmonitored settings. So people, provide the data that they have, but it's not collected in the same way. And it's very hard to interpret. And really the reason that we have this kind of setup goes back to thalidomide, which probably you've mostly heard about was a horrible sort of thing that happened in the 70s. Where we were giving thalidomide for nausea and pregnancy and end up causing, really bad birth defects. These limb defects are kind of the most well known. But the thing to know about thalidomide, which has kind of shaped everything we do for research in pregnancy, is that it's probably one of the most teratogenic medications we have ever seen. So one in every four babies that was exposed to lidocaine in the first trimester had a birth defect. That's crazy. I mean, most other teratogens we know of are like one in 100, one in 1,000. But we set up these systems to collect something that happened in one in four. So it's just not working for pregnancy safety data as we know it. And then another challenge that I specifically get annoyed by is that teratogens are often narrowly defined as medications that cause birth defects. And pharmacovigilance efforts fail to kind of evaluate for other potential harmful fetal effects. And it's really important to recognize the range of potential harmful effects from a medication. You can have pregnancy complications like weight gain, hypertension. You can have non-birth defect birth outcomes, preterm delivery, stillbirth. There's childhood morbidity and mortality. And then there's long-term pediatric outcomes, even malignancy. And I think besides thalidomide, the reason we think about birth defects as the thing that we worry about is because it's easy to assign causality in an individual level to a birth defect, right? The mom was on something, the baby has a birth defect, we think it's the medication. It's really hard to assign causality for these other outcomes, like preterm delivery, which is very common. And it's hard to say, was it the medication? Was it something else? So we kind of just focus in on birth defects because we feel a lot of responsibility and blame there, whereas we don't have that kind of reaction to these other outcomes. So we kind of think of them as not necessarily related to the drug, even though they could be, because it's hard to tell. And then the last challenge to studying drug safety that's really specific to HIV and antiretrovirals is that the majority of exposures have been occurring in countries where systematic surveillance for safety of the drugs in pregnancy hadn't been there for many years. So this is how we come to Botswana, which is not sort of a random place to work, but it's actually a really, really good place to work to do this kind of study. And in Botswana, we first of all have the ability to capture outcomes really well. And this is kind of doesn't come naturally to us who've worked in the United States, but every pregnant person, when they show up for their antenatal visit, they get a booklet. And everything goes in that booklet, their medication prescriptions, their history, their lab results. And in Botswana, 99% of people bring that booklet to delivery. So we can really capture what's happened in most cases. And then Botswana, unlike some other countries in Southern Africa, almost everybody delivers in a healthcare facility, not at home. A termination of pregnancy is basically illegal in Botswana, and that's obviously not a good thing, but it does allow us to sort of know what happens in pregnancies. And then, of course, there's a huge number of exposures in Botswana, and I mentioned this earlier, but the HIV prevalence is still about, close to 25% in pregnancy. Botswana has done an amazing job getting people on antiretrovirals, so more than 95% of people with diagnosed HIV are on ART, and now actually closer to 75% have started prior to conception. And then, Botswana, for many different reasons, which I won't get into, has really been at the cutting edge of antiretroviral treatment in Southern Africa, and are also often the first to do a lot of these interventions. So in this context of Botswana, we started the SAPAMO study. It's a birth outcome surveillance study, began in August of 2014. It's funded by NACHD and Roger Shapiro is the PI. And the primary aims of SAPAMO were first to evaluate adverse birth outcomes by HIV status and antiretroviral treatment regimen, and also to determine if there was an increased risk of neural tube defects among infants exposed to efavirenz from conception. And in case people weren't practicing during this time,
Efavirenz was avoided in women of reproductive age. It was category D. It was basically not used in women because the preclinical studies in monkeys showed that 3 of the 20 infant monkeys had a severe CNS defect after exposure to efavirenz from conception. But what happened was TDF-FTC efavirenz became the first one pill once a day. It was very clear that that was better than what we had mostly been using, which was nevirapine and lopinavir, ritonavir, lots of pills, lots of toxicity. And so in 2012, WHO put it as first line, recommended it as first line treatment. And the same year, Botswana was really among the first African countries to fully implement TDF-FTC efavirenz as first line for all adults, including pregnant women. And so Botswana is a pretty small country. There's 2 million people in a place the size of Texas. So we basically did birth outcome surveillance at 8 of the largest maternity wards. And this covered 45% of all the births in the country. And we had planned to do this study for a 4-year period to end in 2018. And we did a sample size calculation based on the ability to detect a 2-fold increase in neural tube defects for efavirenz, expecting about 1 per 1,000, which is sort of the reported prevalence of NTDs. And the approach that SAPAMO takes is pretty simple. We just have research assistants who abstract data from that maternity card that I talked about for all deliveries, anyone of any HIV status. And again, there's a ton of information on there. We have about 700 questions in our questionnaire. And then for detecting congenital abnormalities, we trained the midwives that work in these hospitals in neonatal exams, which they were already doing, but just to be sort of standardized about it. They record any detail of an abnormal surface exam in that card. And when they notice an abnormality, they call our research assistants, and our research assistants go to attempt to consent the mother for a photograph of the abnormality. And we have these photographs reviewed by a medical geneticist at Mass General who's blinded to the exposure information. So the first analysis we did in SAPAMO was to evaluate adverse birth outcomes by HIV status and ART regimen at conception. And this was back in 2017. To me, this was a really important finding. And what we did is the light bars are any adverse birth outcome, and the dark bars are severe adverse birth outcomes. And we looked at these by antiretroviral regimen at conception. There was TDF-FTC efavirenz there in the pink and red, and we compared that to nevirapine-based regimens and lopinavir-ritonavir-based regimens. And it turned out that efavirenz seemed to be much safer than these other ART regimens. And although the bars aren't that big, these are unbelievably huge clinical differences, right? 36 versus 48% adverse outcomes, 12% versus 20% severe. And this included stillbirth, neonatal death, birth before 32 weeks, or less than the third percentile weight for age. So really severe outcomes. These were all statistically significant, and we, everyone was relieved that this is what it looked like with efavirenz, because this is sort of where things were headed, but nobody, there was no warnings, there was no guideline changes, even though, that there was some pretty terrible outcomes with nevirapine and lopinavir. And, in the US, we weren't really using these drugs. And I think that's why there wasn't a whole lot of sort of talk about this, but they were actually still in the guidelines, the WHO guidelines at the time. So nevirapine was an alternate first line regimen for pregnant or breastfeeding people, and lopinavir, ritonavir was the preferred second line. And a lot of countries hadn't actually transitioned to efavirenz yet, and were still using these medications. But again, nobody sort of made any big deal about this. So SAPAMO continued. This was after our 2-year analysis. And in mid-2016, Botswana became the first African or really high burden country to change their first line antiretroviral treatment from TDF-FTC efavirenz to TDF-FTC plus dolutegravir, and the first country in the world to recommend the use of dolutegravir in pregnancy. And since SAPAMA was already in place when Botswana did this, we were really able to provide the first safety data on dolutegravir when it was started during pregnancy. And we reported this at the AIDS conference and then published it later that year. And kind of unlike those bars I showed you earlier, the dolutegravir and the efavirenz, again, started during pregnancy, had very similar outcomes in terms of birth outcomes. There was also no notable increased risk of birth defects among a real small number, 280 women, who started their dolutegravir in the first trimester. So this was great. And, you know, building on a lot of things, but including this pregnancy safety data, PEPFAR started planning for dolutegravir to become the first line regimen for most high burden countries with a rollout for late 2018. And there was a WHO guidelines committee meeting set for May with really a plan to make dolutegravir their first line preferred regimen for all as well. And so they asked us in SAPAMO to provide data on dolutegravir started before pregnancy, taken at conception, as again, because Botswana was the first to do this, we were the only people who had this data in the world. And unfortunately, what we found when we did that was that four of the 426 dolutegravir conception exposures had a neural tube defect, a prevalence, you know, close to 1%. And again, we were expecting 1 in 1,000, and this was 1 in 100. We had a large number of other groups, you know, 11,000 people on other ART at conception and about 6,000 specifically on efavirenz, and more than 66,000 without HIV. And, you know, really immediately, as was mentioned before, there was a lot of safety warnings put around dolutegravir in pregnancy from all the WHO, FDA, the EMA. And, you know, not only did this really disturb a lot of very important research studies that were going on, there was no easy solution for this clinically or in a policy way. You know, here in the United States, where we weren't recommending efavirenz anymore because it really isn't as good as dolutegravir. For pregnancy, we recommended raltegravir, atazanavir, darunavir, knowing that there's really no similar data. Really, we didn't know whether any of those could be causing neural tube defects or other defects because we don't have conception data, but we sort of chose those without data over some with data. In places like Nigeria and Uganda, they recommended efavirenz for women and dolutegravir for men, creating this gender inequity in HIV treatment. In places like Brazil and Kenya, they required people to prove they were on effective contraception to get dolutegravir, creating barriers to engage in HIV care. And we all knew that there was really not great access to contraception in a lot of these places. And in Botswana, they recommended individualized treatment choice with counseling, which, you know, I think is a very good approach, but they did this in a setting where people were seeing 50 to 60 clients in a clinic session, and there wasn't a lot of treatment literacy, so it just didn't work. Fortunately, as we continued SAPAMO and had increasing number of conceptions on dolutegravir, the signal for neural tube defects went away completely. We basically reported every year at the AIDS conference the prevalence, and it went from, you know, 0.94 in 2018 all the way down to 0.11 in 2022, when by that point we had more than 9,000 conception exposures. And, you know, I wish I could stand here and tell you why this happened, how we could never have this happen again. I would really, really love that. We don't know. We don't know why it happened. We don't know why it went away. There was a higher prevalence with people who conceived on dolutegravir in 2017 than in all subsequent years, where there was very normal prevalence. We looked intensively at what was going on in that year, there was no difference in maternal factors that we knew to be associated with neural tube defects. So no more maternal diabetes, no increased obesity, no increased people with epilepsy or on antiepileptics, no increased folate at conception or even during pregnancy. There was no change at any time in the government folate fortification or supplemental programs. We did uncover that one company started voluntarily putting folic acid in sorghum in 2018, but it's very hard to connect all this or think that this played some kind of major role in folate supplementation. We looked at weather patterns, heat, cold, rainfall, and we just couldn't, we haven't found anything to explain this. And, you know, some people have suggested that maybe we shouldn't have been so surprised that this happened and went away. And when you look at all the CDC investigations of clusters of birth defects, almost none of them have identified a cause, and in no case did the cluster persist. So this is, you know, fairly common thing to happen with clusters of birth defects. There's also a very similar story with lamotrigine at conception, where they found when they looked at their first 684 exposures that there was 10 times the number of oral clefts with lamotrigine. And then as they continued the study and they got to their 2000, the prevalence, you know, there was only one more oral cleft in about 1500 more exposures, completely went away. And I think that there is just this, these are such rare events. There's a lot of chance going on, especially with small numbers, that's hard to appreciate in the moment. But you know, I think this may just be sort of what happens. So, you know, there's a million lessons that I learned from this sort of saga with DTG and NTDs. And I wanted to focus on just two because I think they sort of have persisted in the way we think about things. And the first is that given the lack of pregnancy data for most outcomes, for most antiretrovirals, we just shouldn't talk about safe versus unsafe in pregnancy. Like, we're never going to know if something is safe. We may know if it's unsafe, but you have to think of it as a risk benefit. And I think what we uncovered with dolutegravir is that an ARV could increase the risk of one thing happening and decrease the risk of another, or have the opposite impact on the mother and the baby's health. So anyway, it's all risk benefit. And these two studies, which were modeling studies, were really critical in making this shift to risk benefit for dolutegravir. And basically what they did is they took our SAPAMO data from 2019. So when the prevalence had gone down a bit, but was still higher. And they modeled what it would look like to use dolutegravir in an entire African population. And both models showed that if DTG were used for everybody, there would be a small number of increased neural tube defects. If you can see on that left-sided panel, two more neural tube defects. But there would be, because dolutegravir was so much more effective, there would be 38 more women alive, 35 fewer sexual transmissions, and 29 fewer transmissions of HIV vertically. Really, this same thing happened in the other study. And this kind of like pushed us to say, okay, we have to recognize the risk versus benefit here. And a second related lesson from the DTG-NTD saga is that, you know, the lack of pregnancy safety data can lead us towards substandard treatment of pregnant people. And I think you can see that in the models of what would have happened with DTG, but also, and we don't talk about this much, but again, efavirenz was avoided in women of reproductive age for years because of this concern for NTDs. And our you know, data showed that there is absolutely no risk of NTDs with efavirenz at conception. And instead, we treated people with nivirapine and lopinavir-ritonavir, which were not only, as we know, more toxic and less effective for the patients, but as we showed in SAPAMO, also with worse birth outcomes. And this is just, and I'm not saying we should have been using efavirenz, but when we don't collect pregnancy safety data, this is what can happen. And I think these two lessons have really helped to shape newer iterations of a lot of different HIV guidelines, including DHHS. And I don't know if people had a chance to look at the updated perinatal guidelines from January, but the guidelines are really trying to shift towards using general principles, kind of recognizing that we don't have a lot of data to make really specific recommendations on, and that shared decision-making is the way to go. Which is again, kind of a risk benefit discussion with your patient. And, you know, I won't go through all of this, but their sort of first point on the first page of the guidelines is that pregnant people are often excluded from clinical trials, resulting in limited data, and pregnancy, lactation, and the potential for pregnancy should not preclude the use of drug regimens that would be chosen for people who are not pregnant. And that should be the guiding principle for how we treat pregnant patients. And similarly, there was this, you know, major shift in the chest and breastfeeding recommendations, where for the eternity of HIV, we've said, you know, women in the United States, or people in the United States, should not chest or breastfeed if they have HIV, period. This guideline suggests that people with HIV should receive evidence-based care, and that if people are suppressed in pregnancy, they should be supported to make the choice for chest or breastfeeding if they want to. And again, I think what happened is there was a lens of risk benefit, right? What is the risk? Now that we have dolutegravir and INSTIs and Biktarvy and people are so well suppressed, there's a tiny, tiny risk of transmission from breast milk. And what about the benefits? We never talked about the benefits, right? And yet we're recommending breastfeeding to everybody else, breast is best. There's so many other benefits. So sort of taking that into account when we make our treatment guidelines. And then, you know, I don't really want to go into COVID, but we didn't do great with pregnancy and COVID vaccines, but there was a big shift in how it was talked about. And I think, again, a lot of this is because HIV researchers were leading COVID trials. And thinking about these issues and recognizing that pregnant patients were going to get COVID. And so there was a way different response in the media and sort of at a lot of different stages where at least this was being brought up, that pregnant people deserve better data on COVID vaccines. And so obviously this lack of pregnancy data isn't just an issue for HIV treatment. The lack of inclusion of pregnant people to me is really a reproductive justice issue. I think we can trust pregnant people to make decisions for their own body, including in research. And then excluding them from trials forces pregnant people and their providers to be the experiment, right? And so the blame comes on pregnant people and their providers and not sort of in a trial kind of setting or with a drug company. So for me personally, the newer phase of my career is pivoting into the safety of antiretrovirals in pregnancy for HIV prevention. I probably pretty clear to most people here why we need to be doing this. HIV prevention among young cisgender women is obviously key to ending the HIV epidemic. We have 60% of new infections in Africa among cisgender women 15 to 24. They're very underrepresented in PrEP users. And several African countries actually have delayed the implementation of PrEP due to a perceived lack of safety data in pregnancy and lactation. And HIV prevention is particularly crucial during pregnancy and lactation, where there is a 2 to 4 times higher risk of HIV acquisition. And I like to say pregnancy is a risk factor for HIV. Maybe it's a marker, but you know, you get pregnant the same way you get HIV with a lot of condomless sex. And when we looked in SAPAMO in this bar chart, so parity was actually an independent risk factor for HIV prevalence. So beyond maternal age, the number of pregnancies that you have had increased your risk of HIV. And so the first line of bars is people who have the prevalence of HIV in their first pregnancy, the second pregnancy, and the third pregnancy over time. But again, 8% in the first, 8 or 9%, 25% if you've had three or greater pregnancies. So what you can imagine here, like ideally, we'd get these people on HIV prevention before their first pregnancy. But even if you can get them on after their first pregnancy, get HIV prevention going, you could have a huge impact on HIV prevention, HIV incidence. And you know, the other important part of preventing HIV in pregnancy and lactation is that you also prevent infant transmissions. We did an analysis in Sapamo where we estimated incident HIV in pregnancy. And we did an analysis that showed that people who had initial negative tests and then seroconverted during pregnancy accounted for about 18% of all the peripartum infant HIV infections. And again, this is because Botswana has done such a good job getting people who know they have HIV on treatment that this group who get incident and unrecognized HIV during pregnancy and during breastfeeding are the ones who are transmitting to their infants now. And this is a UNAIDS sort of graph of, you know, why pediatric HIV infection is happening. And incident HIV during breastfeeding is now the second leading cause of pediatric HIV. So when results from HPT-NO84 showed that CAB-LA PrEP was 9 times more effective in preventing HIV infection in cisgender women compared to oral TDF, and this Botswana had been a trial site in 084, I think we all felt immediately like we needed to be doing this in our population. And you know, CAB-LA can be, as an injectable, particularly effective in the postpartum period when adherence to a daily medication is extremely difficult. So it's kind of a good time to do an injectable, but also pregnancy and delivery is a time when otherwise healthy young people access healthcare. And a lot of studies have shown that people are quite motivated to stay healthy when they're pregnant or when they've just had a baby. So I was really lucky to be funded by NICHD to do this work for my first R01 and to study the safety, efficacy, and feasibility of CAB-LA PrEP in a breastfeeding population in Botswana. We call this Sirilezo. And the aims here are to evaluate uptake, adherence, and implementation metrics of CAB-LA to evaluate safety in postpartum women and their breastfed infants, and also to evaluate pharmacokinetics in postpartum women and their breastfed infants. So basically what we're doing, just a brief overview, is that we're going to enroll 500 women without HIV who've just delivered their baby and are still on the maternity ward and offer them PrEP there for 2 years. The initial CAB-LA injection is going to happen before they're discharged from maternity, and the follow-up injections are at their local clinic where they bring their infant for monthly infant checks. So it fits in with a schedule that they're already going to be involved in. We have a bunch of implementation outcomes as well as safety outcomes. We have a PK sub-study. We're looking intensively at 30 mother-infant pairs, but we've also been able to add on hair sampling for all participants, thanks to Monica. And we have a qualitative sub-study where we're doing in-depth interviews, both with participants who are enrolled at several different time points, but also people who are eligible for enrollment and did not want to enroll specifically because they didn't want the CAB-LA. So, you know, just to touch briefly on where this is going, where I want this to go, you know, I talked a lot. This has been my sort of research in medication safety in pregnancy. I also have a lot of interest in improving the birth outcomes among people living with HIV and have sort of some other streams of work there. But for this medication safety part, you know, I'd really like to be doing this during pregnancy, starting during antenatal care. You know, I have I'd love to be using lenacapavir when that is possible. And then also just improving systems for collecting this pregnancy safety data, specifically in sub-Saharan Africa, but there's a lot of different exposures. We can get a lot of information about TB drugs, malaria drugs, you know, different kinds of things, which we can't do as well in other settings. And, you know, my long-term goal, which is really to kind of have a network style collaboration but for observational studies that collect data in pregnancy and lactation, and not necessarily just for HIV, but for a lot of different infections and viral illnesses. So I think I've run out of time, but there's so many people to thank. Really, the team on the ground in Botswana is absolutely amazing. We have research assistants who sit at these, you know, far out maternities collecting data day in and day out on their own. And they have really been the people why we have this data in the first place. My main mentor has been Roger Shapiro, and he has been amazing. And then there's, you know, tons of staff on the ground and the Ministry of Health. And then just because it's kind of early stage investigator day, I wanted to thank my family for sort of helping me through this entire thing, and for people to know that, you know, it can be a challenge to do this kind of life with kids. And it also has been a huge plus for me personally. My older son got to live in Botswana for a couple of years. My kids are literally the best people on airplanes. We could send them to like Australia and they would just be like, yeah. My older son actually wants to be a pilot. So yeah. And so it's definitely a doable, and it actually has a lot of benefits. So thank you so much. And I'm happy to take questions or at least.
That was terrific. I was struck by the example he gave of lamotrigine and the other cluster, you know, data which showed declines over time after initial report. And I wonder if this is like just like regression to the mean phenomenon, because we only focus on those at increased risk, right? We never look at those at decreased risk. And your first study, some people could have interpreted that as, oh gosh, efavirenz actually lowers the risk of birth defects, right?
Right. Yeah. No. I mean. And it did actually look for a while, like statistically, there was a lower risk in efavirenz. And we never said that or support. Now it's kind of, again, as you say, yeah, it's hard to study rare events. But we didn't know. What if it was actually 10 times that much? I mean, I you know, in the moment, it feels very different.
Dr. Zash, thank you so much, first of all, just for your leadership in this area and following the data out and all that you've done for sort of research on ARVs and pregnancy. I think you've been such an inspiration to so many of us, so thank you. I was wondering, in terms of your study and thinking about CABLA in pregnancy, kind of what you think about data so far, and what are sort of the next steps in terms of getting CABLA to pregnant people who may be interested in using it?
Yeah, I mean, you know, that the sort of reported data is from 084 and the 084 extension. I think they, if I have the numbers right, they had something like 60 pregnancies reported. And there's, you know, no signal, but again, that's 60 pregnancies. And originally in 084, when people became pregnant on CABLA, they were stopped. So we don't really have PK data. But again, you know, so for me, when people ask me, it is risk benefit, right? If we are giving CABLA to somebody at very high risk of HIV who is pregnant because they can't take pills, don't want to take pills, won't take pills, and like have a true risk of getting HIV, I think probably the CABLA is the benefit is there. You know, preventing HIV in pregnancy and breastfeeding, that benefit outweighs, you know, a lot of things. And there may be, I don't know, weight issues, something, you know, but it's an INSTI, and we have a lot of data on INSTIs. So there's not really a theoretical risk, in my opinion. So that's how I approach it.
Rebecca, that was a great talk, and it was quite a dramatic story. I remember sitting in rounds, like I was attending, and then I looked down at my phone and I said, nah, like with the toilet takeover thing. So it was really just quite a story. I guess speaking to that, you probably talked a lot to the FDA around that time. And why can't why is it allowed that the FDA can put out, you have to have enough women versus men, you have to have pregnant women in trials, you have to have diversity in trials, and they can't regulate that when it comes to approving a drug? Like even something like elvitegravir actually was studied in 92% men, and you could theoretically say we didn't have enough data in women. Like, why can't, you know, why can they say that in their recommendations and then not enforce it?
Yeah, I mean, I think there is no enforcement mechanism. They can't. And there was a lot of talk, you know, that I wasn't necessarily involved in, but I heard of, like, there should be a fund from every company who puts a drug out for the pregnancy safety study, right? Like, as soon as you know something is effective, you start planning for that, and it just needs money. And none of that has come to fruition, because I think it's a difficult process to get these regulations into place. And it's really, really unfortunate. And, you know, and the problem with getting cisgender women into a lot of these studies and even having representation is there are still contraceptive requirements to get into most of these studies. And that is a huge barrier to getting women in, period. You know, in 084, the open label extension, the nice thing is they took away the contraception requirement, which sounds very small, but it was a huge step. And they're following the pregnancies. Like, it is better than it used to be, but we need a huge change for things like HIV, COVID, where pregnant people are getting these and are gonna be treated whether you do the studies or not. Like, it's obvious.
I don't have a question, but great talk. Thank you.
Thanks. Thanks so much. All right.
Oh, I wasn't ending it necessarily.
Hello. All right. Thank you, everybody. We're going to switch now to the CFAR Excellence Awards. All right. Thank you, everybody. And thank you for staying here through these awards. So this is actually the 9th annual CFAR Excellence Awards, and we give them out each year for clinical, translational, behavioral, social behavioral sciences. And it's run through the CFAR mentoring program, which is in its 18th year. So quite a long history of the program and the awards. And for those of you online or new to the program, so the CFAR mentoring program is every year there is a nomination for the postdocs that are just entering the UCSF system, as well as junior faculty, to engage in a 12-month long mentoring program where we provide senior mentorship, seminars on key issues, negotiation, grant writing, time management that Monica leads, which is also co-directed by my colleague here, Dr. Jonathan Fuchs. And through that program, we get nominations for these awards, which are really centering on sort of the ESIs that are going to be the future leaders of HIV science. And so for today's talk, we have three awardees. We'll have brief introduction by a mentor of theirs, and then they'll give a presentation, and then we'll have time for photos and then a celebratory lunch after this. So I'm going to pass it to my colleague, Dr. Jonathan Fuchs.
Great. Thank you, Dr. Ceseda. So we're very excited to confer this first award to Dr. Appa on research excellence for HIV clinical science. And to introduce her, I'm very happy to bring up Dr. Monica Gandhi. Thank you.
Well, this is a really competitive process, so we're really excited that Dr. Ayesha Appa won the Clinical Research Award in Excellence this year. Dr. Appa started out at medical school at UCSF, then went to University of Washington and was a chief resident there, did a lot of work in disparities and diversity, and really interested in this, in the population of women and also the population that's affected by social determinants of health, and then came back to UCSF for her fellowship and was so interested in social determinants that she ended up doing an addiction medicine fellowship with her ID fellowship. So is the only double boarded person at UCSF and just a handful in the country, and has done extremely well during her fellowship, really a lot of publications, smaller grants, and then ended up just transitioning to a K grant, Mentor Career Development Award, K-12 in women's health, and just started on faculty 2 days ago. So this is Dr. Assistant Professor Ayesha Appa, Clinical Research Awardee. Thank you so much for all the work that you've done.
Oh, thank you so much, Monica. I'm going to leave this here if this doesn't break something. Okay, great. Thank you.
Thank you so much for the kind introduction, Monica. I'm really honored to be here today and share results of our study entitled Rethinking Risks, Opioid-Dependent Chronic Pain and Stimulant Use Among People Living With and Without HIV. I have no conflicts of interest to disclose, apart from sharing that this is an area in which there have been large sea changes in clinical practice, and so I'm hoping for some smoother waters slightly after the next 10 minutes or so. A couple seconds on my personal background. As Monica mentioned, I recently completed fellowships in both infectious diseases and addiction medicine, and as of Monday, I'm new faculty in our division of HIV, ID, and global medicine. My goals are to lead studies developing effective patient-centered models of care to simultaneously treat HIV and substance use disorders. I think that, you know, what I will share with you today is one project which I hope has some actionable take-homes for those of you caring for people living with HIV and chronic pain on opioids. So I think as many know, chronic pain, long-term opioid therapy and stimulant use are incredibly prevalent among people living with HIV. I think I'm curious, you know, raise your hand if you study or care for people living with HIV. This almost everyone in the room, right? Keep your hand raised if chronic pain is something they contend with. Keep your hand raised if they're on opioids. Do you have anyone on opioids? And hands raised if anyone uses stimulants. Yeah, there's essentially most of the room. I think that that reflects how relevant this topic and how ensnared many of these issues are with one another. And I think the other really important piece of context is that in the past 20 years, there have been major shifts in the care for people living with HIV and those with chronic pain that can leave providers uncertain about how to manage long-term opioid therapy, especially in the context of, quote, you know, high-risk behavior or what we'll focus on today, which is stimulant use. So just to be explicit about this, you know, HIV has gone from a terminal diagnosis in which we're deploying palliative treatments like opioids, you know, freely to a chronic disease model in which we're focused on longevity. Chronic pain went from a, you know, fifth vital sign liberally treated with opioids to worry about sort of provider relationship to the increasing overdoses nationally, which led to, you know, large-scale discontinuation of long-term opioid therapy. And then, you know, we've continued to see just an onslaught of overdose deaths in the country as, you know, we've approached 1 million overdose deaths since 1999. And this continues to be at an all-time high. So, you know, a number of issues in which there've been a sea change or a pendulum that has swung. And I think, you know, one thing to highlight as we saw a considerable amount of long-term opioid therapy therapies being discontinued in patients across the country, as they're, you know, in response to, say, the 2016 CDC guidelines that urged caution in the context of, again, sort of quote high-risk behaviors. What has been demonstrated in more recent years is that these discontinuations can be associated with or have been associated with increases in overdose, in opioid overdose, that is just a difficult entity in which we have to contend with, again, balance risk and benefit. And so in 2022, there were updated CDC guidelines that really emphasize non-dogmatic application of this sort of caution in prescribing for people who use stimulants and individual risks and benefits. Then this is compared to the prior set of guidelines. But there really are limited data quantifying the risks associated with stimulant use in established patients on long-term opioid therapy to guide clinical practice. So our objective in this project was to determine if a urine drug test positive for stimulants was associated with incident opioid-related harm and subsequent long-term opioid therapy discontinuation in a publicly insured population with a high proportion of people living with HIV. We designed this retrospective cohort study in which it was called the opioid discontinuation study, of which Dr. Philip Coffin, one of my mentors at the PI, 300 people living with HIV on long-term opioid therapy for chronic non-cancer related pain were matched to 300 patients without HIV with similar age, race, ethnicity, and sex. These are our patients, all affiliated with San Francisco Health Network clinics. I think really relevant to those of you in the room practicing. And patients were followed between January 2012 and 2019. And using logistic generalizing estimating equations, we assessed, you know, there were two main analyses that I'll share with you. One, whether the stimulant positive urine drug test results were associated with increased opioid-related ED visits or opioid overdose death in the subsequent 90 days, and also whether the stimulant positive urine drug tests were associated with opioid therapy discontinuation. Told you about this. And so next I'll share results that are select in the sake of time. And if we have time for questions, can share some additional. But first, here are some demographic characteristics of our sample that sort of stratified between participants with at least one stimulant positive urine test during the study and compared to those without any. I think what I'll draw your attention to, as expected, there are more people living with HIV in the sort of any stimulant positive urine drug test group. And then jumping to our main sort of finding of that first analysis that I mentioned in methods, here are hazard odds of ED visit for opioid-related harm or overdose death following stimulant positive urine drug test or following urine drug test. And as you can see, there is no statistically significant association found between stimulant positive urine drug test and opioid-related ED visitor death within 90 days. This relationship did not differ by HIV status. And then with regards to our second analysis related to discontinuation, you know, what we found was that stimulant positive urine drug tests were associated with subsequent discontinuation within 90 days, with the odds ratio you can see there almost 2. And when we calculated interaction terms between our covariates and independent-dependent variables, found that this relationship between stimulant positive urines and discontinuation was more likely among Latinx patients and less likely among people living with HIV, which again may or may not surprise some of you. In other words, you know, with a stimulant positive urine drug test, those this is sort of oriented towards patients, but providers were perhaps less likely to discontinue their long-term opioid therapy for pain. So, you know, a few limitations of our work. Our defined outcome was opioid-related ED visits and opioid overdose death, which may not encompass the full scope of opioid-related harm. This is a retrospective study utilizing chart review. And so, you know, these urine drug tests are not performed uniformly across patients, and there's some amount of ascertainedness that is certainly incorporated here. And as I mentioned, sort of this pendulum swinging, our current provider behavior may not reflect the 2012 to 2019 practice patterns, though stimulant use and related morbidity mortality is on the rise dramatically. And so I think it's important for us to think about how it affects our patients. So in conclusion, we found no statistically significant association between stimulant positive urine drug tests and our measure of opioid related harm in people with chronic pain living with and without HIV. Despite this, stimulant positive urine drug tests often led to long-term opioid therapy discontinuation, and there was heterogeneity across the demographic clinical groups of discontinuation. And I think when thinking about our, you know, population in those living with HIV and those caring for people living with HIV, it's unknown whether, you know, our finding around the negative interaction between stimulant positive urine drug test and discontinuation reflects a more holistic approach to patient care in which you have multiple visits, you know, providers really know their patients well or treating them as humans, or whether that's difficulty with opioid stewardship, as folks have described in years past, or both. And I think overall, what I suggest taking away from this work is that detection of stimulant use should result in an exploration or a discussion of substance use and risk, rather than a reflex, I must discontinue this person's long-term opioid therapy. So with that, I'll just share a couple of next steps for me personally. The combo study is work that is mentored by Dr. Monica Gandhi and Dr. Philip Coffin, in which we will sort of, again, focus on our patients living with HIV and comorbid stimulant use disorder and aim to expand evidence-based treatment for stimulant use disorder, which is contingency management, to support reduced stimulant use and increased ART, tenofovir-based ART adherence, in and build that into Ward 86. We'll be enrolling female identifying patients starting this summer, and hopefully broader implementation to 86 in the coming year. I'm doing a similar project that I've sort of piloted in the inpatient setting, and we'll be doing a second wave again in hospital setting, incentivizing both infection treatment and stimulant opioid use reduction. And then, just to share clinically, I work in HIV primary care at Ward 86 in the pop-up program, serving people experiencing homelessness in a drop-in low barrier model women's clinic, and attend on both ID and addiction care teams. So thank you so much to a phenomenal set of mentors and collaborators, of which this is not a full list. I presented an area that, again, we've seen swings of the pendulum, and I'm hoping we can move the needle in care for people who use drugs living with HIV. Thank you for your attention.
Great. Thank you so much, Dr. Appa. Fantastic talk. Any questions from the audience? Currently don't have any online. If you are online and like to ask a question, please put it in the chat. Just, I have a question about, you talked about the CDC guidance, you know, still being a bit equivocal. We think a lot about the clinician outreach we do through academic detailing, and based on your findings, what would be some of the key messages you would share with clinicians that are working with folks on chronic opioid therapy and might be using stimulants?
That's such a great question, Dr. Fuchs. I think, you know, one thing that was true in 2016 guidelines and is still true in 22 guidelines, I think we all as providers, it's easy to interpret, say, use caution in prescribing as, oh, I must discontinue my opioids. When in reality, I think that the authors of the guidelines were trying to urge restraint sort of in both sets of years in new prescriptions. And I think thinking about those on established long-term opioids for pain are really like two separate entities. There is sort of new start opioids for pain, and then there, you know, how do you manage someone who's been on their opioids for years? And really what I'm focused on today was that second category. So I think it's important to think about those two as different, as one, I think, reminder. And then I think that the big take home is really what I shared, is that, you know, if your patient has a new stimulant positive urine drug test in the setting of your long-term opioid prescription, really, I think what that should signal is, actually one of my colleagues in the SFHN network presented a like green light, yellow light, red light model. And rather than either red, which we used to maybe default to in 2010, or green, which would be pendulum swinging sort of back the other direction, like it's yellow light, let's stop, slow down, have them come in more often, learn just more about their use and risks. Yeah, thanks.
Steve, here you go. I should probably know this, but you know, that period of time in 2016 when we were getting people off of these long-term opioids was very challenging for me as a clinician, because I had a lot of people who'd been on it for a while, and there were a lot of people benefited, and there's a lot of people who I think less so in terms of indirect harm between my relationship with the patient and so forth, a lot of mistrust. It was difficult. So I'm curious, what was the modeling shown in terms of the benefit long-term in terms of opioid overdoses among people, two groups, among people who are taking opioids and then indirectly, I guess, people who are selling it and so forth. Yeah. How much benefit came from all that?
Yeah, that's a really great question. You know, I think Dr. Deeks, like, was all of that anguish on the part of the provider and then the patients experienced sort of what objective and quantitative benefit was there for those who may have been, one, diverting their medication, or two, at risk of opioid use disorder. And, you know, I will say, I'm actually not familiar with the literature around benefit. I think most of what I have been aware of are published data around, I think because everyone was assuming, overdoses are going like this, we are physicians and we were sort of complicit in prescribing these, we must stop them. And instead of any sort of positive or a deflection in the negative direction, the inverse happened, like we just, our opioid overdoses kept skyrocketing. And so I think that the literature that I'm familiar with is, again, sort of this worry that that reflex discontinuation actually just sort of made things worse for that group that was dependent, and, you know, physically and otherwise. How much diversion, you know, is relevant is, I think, is something to think about. I'm not aware of a sort of quantitative study, though. Yeah.
Please. Yeah. One option. It's on. One option we're often taught about is using buprenorphine for pain, and I've had some success using that in new starts, but it seems like whenever I switch my patients on chronic opioids to buprenorphine, it never works. Curious what your experience is with that. And
Yeah. That's a great question. I have had, I'd say, a limited small amount of experience with new start buprenorphine for pain in people that had been that are opioid naive or had, it had been a number of years since they had been on full agonist opioids. And I'd say I've had mixed results in that some are pleased with it. And there are some, for those that are truly opioid naive, the option of having a patch on and not having to take daily pills can be a really nice option. In switching people from full agonist opioids to a partial agonist, buprenorphine, I think that it can be rocky. It can be a rocky road. And I have not, I think that there, I'm thinking of one patient in particular who has done well, and that's my N of one. But I think that the take home there for me is sort of having patience with yourself and the patient around the process. Like, I think that the reasons you would switch, Matt, like that you're outlining, are you're worried about opioid use disorder, that someone is no longer sort of in control of their opioid use and you want them on a life-saving treatment for opioid use disorder. Or there is some other safety benefit, like you're worried about, they have COPD and you're worried that, you know, you don't want something that's going to cause respiratory depression. And so there are different speeds, there are sort of different reasons that you're going to do it. And I think, like, just partnering with your patient and saying, like, this may feel different, you may not like it, this, you know, I'm here with you throughout this process, is an important one. And then phoning friends, I think, but it's hard. I'll acknowledge that.
Please join me in congratulating Dr. Appa for her award. Thank you. Thank you for excellent talk.
Great. And so next up, it's my pleasure and honor to introduce Dr. Carol Dawson Rose, who's going to introduce our next awardee, Dr. Jerry Nutor.
Good morning, everybody. I'm excited that I get to be here today with you all and to introduce Dr. Jerry Nutor, who is the recipient of the Social and Behavioral Research Excellence Award. Can you hear me? Are you saying up or?
No, you're okay.
Okay, cool. Thanks. I was like, what's that mean? There's so many things to tell you about Jerry. And I also want to acknowledge that Sherry Weiser, who is one of his co-mentors, we nominated him for this award, is at a meeting in DC right now and maybe on Zoom at this moment. But Jerry is an assistant professor in the School of Nursing. He joined us at UCSF in 2019. Prior to that, he earned his PhD from Temple University and then completed a postdoc in global health and health policy from Princeton University. He is also, his recent achievements that are vast, he's doing amazing research And also he has started a nonprofit organization in Africa to bring together interdisciplinary health professionals and to increase their capacity in research. And he's been part of training over 45 individuals in this South to South collaboration. He's also been named a 2023 Carnegie African Diaspora Fellow. There are so many other things, but that's what I'm going to give you today. His title of his talk is Intention to Behavior, the Impact of Water Insecurity and Adherence to Antiretroviral Therapy Among Pregnant and Postpartum Women. Oh, cool. Yay.
Sherry, if you want to unmute.
Yes. Hello. I just wanted to echo Carol's congratulations. Jerry has done exceptional work on so many levels, including Herculean efforts to put together two R01s that are going in, or at least R01 responses that are going in at the end of the week. And so I'm sorry that I can't be in there in person, but Jerry, this is extremely well-deserved and very, very much looking forward to your talk. Thank you.
Thank you so much. And just like it's been said, it takes a village to raise a child. I have so many parents and so many mentors, and I'm so grateful for these mentors and the guidance that I've been receiving so far. And it's great to be here and to be awarded these award, because I think it's a great achievement, and I appreciate this opportunity. Since this is award talk, I'm just going to go a little bit overview of what I'm doing, where I started and where I'm heading to, and not really dipping down into my particular research. So thank you so much. And thank you, Dr. Zash, for that presentation. I think it laid some important ground for my talk as well. And I'm looking forward to meeting you after lunch today. Thank you. So, okay. All right, so this is my research interest, and I'm interested in understanding the impact of environmental, that is water or food insecurity, social and economic, and factors with particular focus on adherence to ART or antiretroviral therapy and prevention of mother-to-child transmission of HIV. And I'm particularly interested in mothers and children affected by the HIV pandemic in Sub-Saharan Africa and the United States. So just a little bit of how all these started. In my PhD program at Drexel University, I got into a program called Downside Global Development Scholars Program that was also supported by World Vision International to go to Zambia on a 6 weeks project, just to work with World Vision and see what they do. For those of you who are aware, World Vision is really, really invested in WASH project, or water hygiene and sanitation project, across the world, especially in low and middle income countries. So I was in the southern province of Zambia, as well as the Lusaka province, and where I was working with all these wonderful World Vision staff, providing water, education, and a lot of things in the community. So I just started a PhD program then, and I was thinking of my research project. So I started talking to folks, especially people living with HIV, the clinic staff, nurses, physicians, and everybody, about what are some of the challenges that their patients and the population that they treat actually face. And it was obvious around that time there was some drought in Zambia, and the medication, the ARTs that the pregnant women and postpartum women were using at that time, they were seeing a lot of side effects relating to diarrhea or GIT problems and a whole lot of things, but there was issue of not having a lot of water in the community. So we started talking, and we saw a huge issue of non-adherence or poor adherence among this population. So I came back to the US and I started doing some literature on this. And we know that pregnant women, even after giving birth need to continue with the ART in order to prevent mother-to-child transmission of HIV to have their viral load actually suppressed. So, and we know the associated factors if there is poor adherence of ART. So I saw this literature and I reviewed and I came back, I came back to my mentors around that time and then we developed this idea. And around that time, since in my understanding, there was not a lot of studies relating to water insecurity or water access and HIV adherence among this population. So I decided to look at adherence intention. And we know that when we take a nurse patient or a provider patient relationship, there are two aspects in this relationship. We have the nurse or the physician who is expert on the care they are delivering, and the patient who is expert of their own health, and they decide what to do and what not to do. Whether it's a prescription or whatever you are giving them, the patient decide whether to or not. And they need to have that intention to take that suggestion or not before they can actually perform that prescription or suggestion that you are giving them. So we see that non-adherence can be classified generally into intentional and non-intentional, such that in a situation where somebody is interested in taking the ART, but they don't have like maybe the drug, they don't have water, they don't have toilet, if they have GIT issues, that they can actually take care of themselves. And then there is a situation where the person decide not to take the medication at all. So I came back, and we know that adherence intention leads to adherence because the person will need to have this adherence or intention before they can move forward to adhere. So in my search, I saw this issue of water supply or access to drinking water globally from this graph. And as you can see, the global south have a lot of issue with water access as well as sanitation issues when you look at the graph in general. And therefore, that's actually lead us to Sub-Saharan Africa and Zambia around that time. And they were also experiencing a lot of drought. And then there was a lot of challenges with access to water. So quick overview of that at this hypo there in part of toilet and water access on ART adherence intention in Zambia. So in my dissertation project, I look at three different aims. I look at attitude and beliefs as one, and then I look at beliefs and attitude that Dr. Zash was talking about, where people were concerned at that time about the safety of the ART on for themselves and their children as well. And so I have a paper on that as well. And then these two papers talk about water access and access to toilet and how those lead to adherence intention. So these actually came out from my dissertation project. Now, leading to that, so this is where my team came from, intention to adherence. After doing that, I decided now looking at the adherence itself in the population, the same population in Ghana. And we just finished, so I'm just giving a brief overview of what we found from that study. That is a pilot, just a preliminary study that we conducted that is leading to one of the R01s that is being submitted at the moment. So we found that people who had generally, just to give a brief overview of this because of time, we saw that majority of people who have or who are water insecure are more likely to have poor adherence to ART. And it's very obvious in the data that we found. And we also model food in, we ran the food insecurity and ART adherence. Interestingly, we did not find a significant relationship, but we think maybe because this is in the urban area of Ghana and some other factors might have led to that. So in summary, We also, so the second point here, we saw that participants with a moderate household water insecurity score had nearly three times greater odds of reporting poor ART adherence compared to those with low household water insecurity score. So in the next steps that I talked about that we are working on, we are trying to look at the role of climate sensitive patterns and seasonality on water insecurity and how these associations may modify by region and individual characteristics. And we picked three regions actually in Ghana, and then we're trying to look at them. So you can, as you can see here, the weather patterns, we have this wonderful a researcher from UC San Diego who is helping out with a remote sensing technology to be able to see the weather pattern and able to connect that to the data to see how this is affecting adherence and other HIV treatment outcome. We selected three regions in Ghana, and based on what we collected so far, we've seen some interesting weather pattern changes there, and that is what we are going to be doing in the if the project is funded. That basically is all, and I want to just thank all the wonderful people and mentors that I have that I think has been great, and the CFAR and ARI have been really supportive of my work, and I really appreciate you for that, for the support. And I just don't want to end here. I also have a wonderful four of my colleagues. We've been this BioPAC faculty in HIV research in the School of Nursing, Orlando, Jose, Natalie, and then we are actually mentored by Milo, who is also in the School of Nursing. I just want to give a shout out to them as well for the support. And Carol mentioned, I can't just finish the presentation without giving you a little bit about the conference that we are organizing. And this is the sixth annual one that we've been organizing. I started this based on the fact that there's this huge disparity about participating in conference from Sub-Saharan Africa. We do all this wonderful research there, and the visa acquisition and financial issue for them to travel to come to conferences in the global north, where almost all the great conferences happen all the time. So we decided to do this, and this is the sixth one. Is wonderful, and if you have collaborators in Sub-Saharan Africa, I strongly encourage you to help them participate in this conference. We had about 200 abstracts, but we decided to open again for a late breaker abstract because of the demand. So that's going to happen between August 9 and 11 this year. So thank you so much for your attention, and I can take questions now.
Great talks. It's such an interesting topic. Questions from, can get started. Jerry, yeah, it's great. You know, my wife is a water security person, so like this, it's great to see the intersections, because most of the time I have no idea what she's talking about with like transboundary. But I'm thinking, you know, the solution is likely geopolitical, kind of just the harnessing of a bunch of different governments. And climate change experts, how do you think about the solution when there's so many key players, because it can't, you know, one country can't do it alone?
Thank you. That's a wonderful question. So in the arrow one that we are designing right now with Sherry and others, and we are actually interdisciplinary in nature. And we met with a program officer who also encouraged us to get policymakers. So we have policymakers on board as a consultant and others involved from the government level and Water Institute there in Ghana as well. So we see this first, as you said, geopolitical and as well as it's interdisciplinary in nature, because if you talk about this is healthcare, but it's also about government and policies and environmental and everything that you can think about. So we are looking at it from that perspective, as well as we, the people who are conducting the research, what are our background and how many experience or expertise do we have from our research portfolio to be able to come together and think about this. And like, again, I'm going to add the, in my opinion, because of the players that are involved in this, we can't have one size fitted all for this solution. It might vary from country to country and maybe from region to region based on the weather pattern that I just showed here. It might vary from region to region as well.
Yeah. Thanks. Monica.
This was really excellent. And I think this is like the question of the day, because in Sub-Saharan Africa, the cholera outbreaks that are happening right now, and we haven't seen cholera, you know, for quite a long time, are related to, I assume, water sanitation and then water insecurity that would make you. So can you speak to cholera at all? I'm just interested in all of IDs as everyone in this room.
Yes, thank you. So at the time, even that I was in first time in Zambia, and that was in 2016, there was a cholera outbreak. And the issue, so when we talk about the water insecurity, first we talk about the lack of the water. It's not there. And also we talk about the contamination, the quality of the water. And we see these in most sub-Saharan African countries or low and middle income countries where the water that is that even go to people's home because of the sanitation area involved in those countries, the water get contaminated because there are leaks of pipe in some gutters somewhere that is not well kept. The sewage system are really poor. That leads to cholera. So in some situation, flooding is another thing that leads to or is a cause of the cholera in some of these countries, because their water, maybe they might be getting this from well, but because there is flooding and then this will get contaminated and there is an outbreak of cholera in the country. So cholera is a big problem that when you look at HIV, ART adherence as well, you look at the side effect based on the drug that the people are taking. They are having this GIT problem. And then when the water is contaminated, they again have cholera. So that's a double problem there that is faced by this population. But that's what I can say about that.
No. Thank you. So let's congratulate Dr. Jerry New one more time.
Thank you, Jerry.
Great, thank you. And for our last talk, we have Dr. Alex Marson, who is joining us remotely and is going to introduce our recipient of the Research Excellence Award in Basic Science, Dr. Ujjwal Rathore. So Alex, are you on? If you want to come off mute.
I am, I'm here. Can you hear
Great.
Me?
Yes, Great. We can.
Well, this is, first of all, I apologize for not being there. I wasn't able to make it. I really wanted to be there. This is a special occasion for Ujjwal, but also for the lab. Ujjwal is remarkably deserving of this award, and this seems like a very fitting honor for many, many contributions that he's made to science, to the lab, to the Genomic Immunology Institute, Gladstone and UCSF. I feel incredibly lucky that Ujjwal reached out and asked to be a postdoc in my lab a few years ago. And since then, he's just astounded me with his persistence, his creativity, and his real drive to do what matters to advance, to come up with new understanding and new solutions for HIV and for other viruses. I'll just say a few things. First of all, I think it's worth mentioning that Ujjwal's postdoc took a bit of an unexpected turn, as did everyone's during COVID, and Ujjwal made sure to take advantage of his deep understanding of virology, making major contributions experimentally to a number of testing and research efforts related to COVID, but also going out of his way to do a major education campaign in India, getting hundreds of thousands of views on YouTube to raise awareness about the importance of vaccination and to build comfort with that. Ujjwal is everything we hope for in a scientist. He's a terrific mentor. He's a collaborator. He's a collaborator in the lab. He's made our science better, but he's also branched out into a network and has really built a community with CFAR, with other leaders in the HIV field. I see Jay Levy's on the call, and Ujjwal has been collaborating extensively with Jay and Nevin Krogan and many others in the room. And that's really his drive and commitment to the science that has led that. Ujjwal took on a tough problem. My interest scientifically has been in the genetics of what controls T cells, but I was originally an infectious disease doctor and worked with people in this room as I was training. And I've long hoped that what the work that we're doing in basic science would have implications for our understanding and hopefully eventually our ability to treat HIV. And Ujjwal has played the real pioneering role in building out that ambition. And he's tackled problems that I never would have fully anticipated, but he's just been relentless in moving the field forward. And the progress that he's making is a testimony to his strengths as a scientist. And in every way, he is deserving. He is an emerging leader in this field. And congratulations, Ujjwal, on this very, very well-deserved honor.
Thank you, Alex.